Earning your PhD degree is not for the faint of heart, but you may be someone who has what it takes. Let's take a look at what some of the key milestones are for earning your PhD. As we look at the typical time frame, the Doctor of Philosophy or PhD typically takes about 3 to 7 years. And the difference in the time here is partially due to if you have a master's degree or not. So if you come in after already completing a master's degree, you're going to be looking at that 3 to 5 year time frame. And if you are coming in what we call direct PhD, so someone coming in with a bachelor's degree, kind of skipping over that master's degree directly into the PhD, you're looking at about 4 to 7 years. And probably the biggest factor in the length of time that it takes you to complete your PhD is the research project that you do and how quickly you work through that research. A lot of being a PhD student is very independent. It's very self-motivated, and it's very much up to you to regulate your time in a way that gets you through the program quickly. As we look at some of the basic requirements of a typical PhD program, 90 credit hours is fairly standard. And here at Purdue, you can use up to 30 credits from your master's degree toward your PhD. And this is fairly common across different universities. And so this is an example of how if you earn that master's degree first, some of those credits can be applied toward your PhD. If you come in with a master's, then you only need 60 credit hours left to complete the degree. Research is required. So when we looked at the master's degree, of course, there's an option there to go thesis or non-thesis. With a PhD degree, research is always required. It is an expectation of the degree that you are going to be doing research. A minimum GPA is required. Again, 3.0 is fairly common, but there are programs that have a higher GPA minimum than this. And like the master's program, you usually will have to complete a seminar course as a PhD student. And if you saw the master's video, then you heard some of the different types of ways that seminar courses are distributed. But just to reiterate that in brief, sometimes these are very research intensive, where different expert research presenters come in and talk about what is happening in your field. Sometimes these are more professional development focused and looking at career development and your planning. And sometimes these are driven by the students in the course itself, where as an upper level PhD student, you would be presenting your research. And as a first or second year PhD student, you would be participating in the audience, giving feedback and learning from some of those upperclassmen. Co-ops and internships are possible, although they are not as common at the PhD level as at the master's level. Typically, if you're doing something like a co-op or an internship as a PhD student, it's usually tied to the research that you're doing. So if you are doing a particular type of research that fits in well, for example, with a national laboratory or some of these major facilities that are shared facilities around the world, then you may actually go and conduct research at these different facilities, either as part of your program or in a kind of co-op or internship type agreement where part of your work is part of that co-op and internship. But often it is still tied to your research and your major focus area. Publication is expected. So the research that you're doing, the expectation is that the results you garner are going to be publishable and that you're going to share this new knowledge that you generate with others. Depending on the discipline that you're in, multiple publications may be expected as part of your PhD career. Some of the key milestones of being a PhD degree seeker. So like with the master's program, the first step is going to be to submit your plan of study. And the first phase of that is to identify your major professor. There are some PhD programs where you will know from the very beginning who your major professor is. Often that's the person who's funding you. Sometimes that is assigned at the time of admission or before you actually start to enroll. Sometimes that major professor is something that you are assigned during your first semester. There may be a series of lab rotations that you go through or a process once you're on campus to determine that match. Once you have your major professor, the next step is to form your advisory committee. So in addition to your major professor, there's usually about three other individuals on your committee. These can be individuals both from your department and usually have at least one from another department, sometimes even from another university, to give an outside perspective on the work that you're going to be doing. And this advisory committee is really formed to help you with your research. These are going to be your advisors. That's what the name implies. These are the people that are going to help you with your research project. Once they are formed, then you will sit down and talk with them about the courses that you need to take that are going to help prepare you for your planned research. And then, of course, you jump in and start that coursework. Part of the PhD program will be made up of classes, but a major component of it is going to be the research that you do. The next major hurdle is to pass the qualifying exam. And this can have different names depending on the discipline that you're in. These may be referred to as quals, area exams, sometimes just the preliminary exam. And the component of it is it's typically a written exam. There may also be an oral component as part of this. It's usually taken in the second year of your PhD program. And the third hurdle is what we call the preliminary exam or the proposal defense. And depending on the discipline you're in and the university, these steps 2 and 3 can sometimes be run together. You'll notice that here, if I go back up a slide, one of the names for a qualifying exam is a preliminary exam. Right? And so sometimes disciplines will call this stage the preliminary exam. And then when you move to step 3, that's more of your proposal defense. So sometimes the terminology can be a little bit different depending on what you're studying, but the main concepts of the steps is the same. So here in step 3, when you're looking at the proposal defense, sometimes also called the preliminary exam, this is the plan for your dissertation research. This is usually done at a minimum 1 year prior to graduation, but usually it's done earlier. So this is your putting together what you plan to do for your research. If you think about the projection of your research plan at this stage, you've probably done some background work. You may have even already run some preliminary experiments to get some pilot data. And you're putting together your main plan for what your contribution to this field is going to be. This is usually a written document. You also usually present this orally to your committee, sometimes to an outside group as well, but definitely to your committee or to your advisory group. Once you have passed this preliminary exam or the proposal defense, then you enter into candidacy. So you change from being a PhD student to being a PhD candidate. Different universities handle this different ways. In some cases, this is kind of a big milestone to have met. Other cases, it's more just a checkbox on a form, kind of officially on the back end, but it doesn't really change your status at the university necessarily. Once you have proposed your research, then obviously the plan is to go out and complete it. So maybe I should have had a step 3A in here, and that is to go out and actually do your research. But once you have done that, then the plan is to successfully defend your dissertation. This is usually referred to as the final defense. It has a very ominous tone to it, doesn't it? But that is where you do an oral presentation, usually to your committee, and also a public presentation that others are invited to. After the public presentation, then you have an oral defense with your committee. So that's a more closed door part of the process where they ask you questions about your work. So when we talk about the dissertation and defending that, let's take a look at what that means. So if you saw the master's video, you may recognize this as kind of what the thesis was. Well, the dissertation is kind of the equivalent of a thesis, but this is for PhD students. And so it usually is bigger. Right? It usually has the same major components. You will usually introduce your research and then have a literature review, which is a review of everything that has happened up until the point that you came along. Right? What is the state of the science, if you will, at the point where you entered in and started your research. You'll have a chapter in there on your research design, which is your materials and your methods, your data analysis, everything you plan on doing. What is your research plan? And then the actual results are where you have executed your plan and are talking about what your results were, what your contribution was. The last section is the discussion, which is where you draw your conclusions, talk about future directions, and wrap up the paper that's there. And of course, I couldn't leave this slide without showing a copy of my dissertation. Usually they're not the most thrilling things to read, but I don't know. If you're interested in the research, then that part can be exciting sometimes too. All right, so just to wrap up here, earning your PhD degree. If you had so much fun that you want to do it again, well, I'm sorry to disappoint you on this one, but it is very rare to earn more than one PhD. Typically, once you have earned one PhD, that is it. That is the end of your educational pursuits in that regard. But the good thing about a PhD is that you never really stop learning, right? That's why you kind of are on this track to begin with, because you love to learn, you love research. There's a lot of careers that you launch into from this PhD that allow you to continue in this area. And then, of course, the very last step that you come to as a PhD student, and that is where you get to put on an amazing gown that looks something like this. Every university kind of has their own style that they use, but you get that diploma and you picture your name right here with the PhD after it. So obviously earning a PhD is a little bit harder than just typing your name in the line there, but I hope that you really do take the time to visualize that and imagine what it looks like to have that PhD after your name, because it is a goal that is attainable if it's something that you have a passion for and want to really go after.